Good morning. Day four of our Life Church. We've been talking about life with Jesus and life in general. You know, how to walk with Jesus in a better way through life. And so we've talked about number one, we talked about no fear. Number two, we talked about hope. Number three, we talked about trust. And today we're going to talk about faithfulness and two aspects of faithfulness, God's faithfulness and our faithfulness, how they're tied together. And I'm glad that God loves us. And you guys got to just hold on to that, because too many times we, especially as Christians, we beat ourselves up because we're not perfect, you know? Well, join the party, you know? None of us are. The Bible says that there are none righteous, no, not one. We're saved by grace. It's not, you know, we're always, as humans, our natural thing is to try to work out our salvation, as in by works. And that doesn't happen. I mean, we're saved through faith. It's the gift of God. And that means we act on it. So there is part of an action, but it isn't works that get us saved. It's He already paid the price for us. We just accept it and walk by faith. And so today, though, we're going to talk about that walking, that steady walking with God, and how He steadily walks with us. I think one of the best guys to talk about that would be Daniel. You know, as far as in the Bible, what a faithful man to God. I mean, he was amazing. You know, just like in my life, if I look at what is faithful, my parents were great as in being faithful. I've had a lot of dogs, and dogs are always known to be faithful. They're an amazing animal as far as, I've seen people mistreat dogs, and yet the dog loves them. I mean, they're an amazing, faithful animal. And I mean, early on when we were kids, we had a dog that fetched. His name was Skip. And Skip was, man, if you threw it, he would faithfully bring it back. I mean, period. And it later on, you know, we kind of ran out of balls and frisbees and all that, but so rocks became the thing. But yeah, he wore his teeth down to nothing. I mean, he had no teeth when he got old, but rocks, if you threw the rock, he'd always bring back the same rock. It didn't matter. It was always the same, always. Once he started with a rock for the day, that was the rock for the day. It was amazing. Just a faithful dog. But Daniel was this man who proved his faithfulness. When Daniel comes into the Bible, he's a captive. He's a young man when it starts out. He's captured and then brought into the king's. The king took the best of the young Jewish guys that were, he felt that since they were young, they were pliable and changeable and teachable, you know. So Daniel was taught everything, you know, but one thing Daniel would not give into was the king versus what he believed as a religious man, as a follower of God. He was going to follow God, period. And Nebuchadnezzar found that out. And later on, when the king of Babylon falls and the Medes and the Persians take out Daniel, immediately shows his wisdom, and the king of the Medes and Persians lifts him up to be one of the top guys in the nation. The problem is, as he became a favorite of the king, the guys who were Medes and Persians that were leaders in the king became jealous kingdom. They were leaders in the kingdom, but they became jealous of Daniel. And so Daniel, you know, that he was a threat to them. At least that's what they saw, because Daniel had become so, he was about to probably become the number two guy in the kingdom. And they didn't want that. He's Jewish. They were jealous. He wasn't a Mede and a Persian. So he tried to find some dirt on him, and they couldn't find any. And that statement right there alone, they couldn't find anything bad. That's amazing. And that's the kind of people we should become, that we, man, we are who we say we are. People don't find dirt on us. They might see that we're not perfect, but they don't find dirt. There's nothing hidden. We are who we say we are. Daniel was that kind of guy. So they decided if they were going to get him, that they were going to get him on something that had to do with his faith. So they went to the king and they fed the king's arrogance and pride by saying, "King, you're doing such an awesome job, oh king, you know. Hey, why don't we, you know, why don't we make a ruling, a law? You know, you're just being such a great guy. We'll just pass this law where you can't pray to another god. Only to you. I mean, because you're so fantastic. Only to you for a month. Let's just do it for a month. You know, a week, it wouldn't matter. We'll just make the people pray to you and you alone." And man, that fed the king's pride and arrogance. And he's like, "Sure, why not? Let's do it." You know, so they make it a law. And these guys, it says they went out. And when you join the story, this is where you find Daniel's faithfulness. Verse 10 of chapter 6 in Daniel, it says, "But when Daniel learned that the law had been signed," so he learned that the king had signed the law, "he went home and knelt down as usual in his upstairs room and with its windows open toward Jerusalem. He prayed three times a day, just as he had always done, giving thanks to God." I mean, as soon as he learned it, he wasn't going to change what he always did. He went home, opened his windows towards Jerusalem, and prayed. And of course, they said, "We got him," you know. And plus, you know, and you guys know the story. They threw him in the lion's den and trying to kill him because of the law. The king didn't want to throw him in the lion's den, but he was trapped, had to do it. So overnight, he's in the lion's den, but God saves him from the lions and they pull him out, you know. And everything falls apart for these guys. They end up getting thrown to the lions. But here's the deal. Daniel prayed. The big thing about the story is not so much that God saved him. I mean, we talked about how God can be trusted. He'll always come through for us. But that ties to faithfulness. He is always faithful, and God desires us to be faithful. And Daniel proved his faithfulness even through all of the stuff going on. He was faithful. Anyhow, so how can we show our faithfulness to God? Oh, we can show our faithfulness to God by we're faithful to read his word. We love to read the word. We're faithful to pray. When we can, we're faithful to church, you know, because the Bible describes us as the body of Christ. So it's great that we're involved in a body of believers. We need to be involved with a body of believers. It's not good for us to be on our own. And then we need to be faithful in our work and in our giving, and that we don't stop giving to God in our time, in our money. You know, now it's kind of hard, so tithing is a little difficult, but God wants us to be faithful in it, that we tithe to God. And so, you know, that's how we show our faithfulness. Now, I just want to read a chapter that tells about God's faithfulness, and then we'll close. Psalm 91 says, "Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust him. For he will rescue you from every trap and protect you from deadly disease." Boy, does that fit us. "And he will cover you with his feathers. He will shelter you with his wings. His faithful promises are your armor and protection. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrows that fly in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in darkness." Here it is again. Fits us. "Nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Though 1,000 fall at your side, though 10,000 are dying around you, these evils will not touch you. Just open your eyes and see how the wicked are punished. If you make your refuge, if you make the Most High your shelter," we've been talking about his faithfulness. Now it's saying, if you are faithful, No evil will conquer you. No plague will come near your home. Speaks to us again. For he will order his angels to protect you wherever you go. They will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. You will trample upon lions and cobras. You will crush fierce lions and serpents under your feet. The Lord says, I will rescue those who love me. I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. That talks about God's faithfulness, but it also talks about ours. So it's tied together. God's always going to be faithful to us, period. Always. It's a given. I mean, you don't even have to doubt it. He will always love you. He will always come through for you, protect you, heal you, deliver you, set you free. If you lean on him, if you're faithful to him, that door even opens wider. So I encourage you, don't give in to fear. Always have hope, always trust, and be faithful in God, because he will be faithful to God. He will always be faithful to you. I thank you for joining us this week. The next time you'll see me will be our Sunday service, because we're only going to do these Monday through Friday. And we'll work on the next one for next Monday at 11 a.m. It'll always be out in the morning. But we love you. We are praying for you that God will protect you. And I encourage you, as God is faithful, you be faithful. Amen.